I want you to listen to these two audio clips and tell me which one you think sounds better. In a moment, I'll reveal the correct answer. And yes, there is a correct answer in this case. But first, I want to tell you a quick story to highlight the point of this video. When I was studying audio production in college, one of my professors was showing us how to use an outboard compressor for mixing a live band. He showed us how to connect the insert of the snare drum channel to the compressor and started to show us how compression could be used to change the tone of the snare. When you're trying to hear compression for the very first time, the difference can be kind of subtle. My classmates and I saw the meters change as the teacher adjusted the settings on the compressor, and listening very closely, we shook our heads in agreement that the compressor improved the sound of the snare drum. That is, until one student noticed that the button on the console to engage the insert wasn't pressed, indicating that the effect of the compressor was bypassed. The improvement was completely imaginary, even though we all heard it. Now, I had and still have a tremendous level of respect for this professor. It was an honest mistake, and he instantly owned up to it and laughed about it. I think that simple mistake turned out to be one of the best lessons that we could have learned. Trust your ears, not your eyes. Getting back to the test at the beginning of this video, you might already see where this is heading. There was no difference at all between the first clip and the second clip. If you thought that you did hear a difference, it was probably just your mind playing tricks on you based on the meters that were on your screen. Trust me, the point of that test was not to make you feel dumb or inadequate. I'm sure I would have imagined a difference myself, and I think that many great mixing engineers would have fallen for the same trick. The point was to demonstrate how powerful our minds are and how easily our eyes can trick our ears. I believe that this is one of the most common mixing mistakes, and this is especially true in today's world with modern audio technology, where every EQ has a real-time frequency analyzer and every compressor has a graphic user interface. In the past, engineers didn't have these luxurious graphical interfaces. All they had were the knobs on their equalizer and their ears. Of course, let's not get carried away here. There is certainly a benefit to the modern tools that we use today and the visual information that they provide. But it is easy to see how relying too much on those tools can have a negative effect on our ability to listen critically and objectively. The effects of mixing with your eyes can come in many forms. I remember listening to the engineer for Fleetwood Mac's album Rumours, Ken Kelay, giving a presentation at an AES convention a few years ago. He mentioned that sometimes the EQ that sounds best isn't necessarily the one that looks best, and he urged mixing engineers to not be shy to use extreme EQ filters if that's what served the mix. At the end of the day, the old rule still holds true. If it sounds good, it is good. For me, relying too heavily on my eyes while mixing becomes especially insidious when it comes to compression. I find myself getting too caught up in targeting a specific gain reduction target rather than listening to what I'm doing. I want to be extra clear here that the problem only arises when you use your eyes instead of your ears. This isn't to say that meters and graphical interfaces aren't helpful. They certainly are. At the most basic level, they help to indicate that an effect is active. Meters are also helpful to set gain structure within a system and to ensure that output peak and loudness levels adhere to industry standards. But I would argue that the benefits of meters and other visual features go far beyond this. Seeing the phase graph on an EQ or seeing the parameters of a compressor or gate graphically are great tools not only for learning and understanding what an effect is doing, but also for identifying and tweaking small details that might not have been noticed with ears alone. Another scenario where meters are really helpful is when hunting for microphone feedback in a live sound scenario. You can do it by ear, but using a frequency graph software like Smart can save you a ton of time. It seems to me that the best approach is one of moderation, where the strengths of the ears and the eyes are allowed to support one another. If you feel distracted by the graphics and meters on your screen, try closing your eyes to give your ears a chance to listen without the influence of the eyes. But at the same time, don't be afraid to use meters to find problems and view things more objectively, because your ears can fool you too. In order to start mixing with your ears, you need to learn to trust your ears. And one of the best ways to do that is with ear training. I want to help you get started right away with a free guide that you can download at audiouniversityonline.com/eartrainingguide. That guide will introduce you to a system that takes 10 minutes to learn and just a few minutes a week to practice using a free tool. To learn more about that ear training method, watch one of the videos that's on your screen now.